The NDP entered the election campaign as the front runners and will return to Parliament as the third place party. The party won nearly 59 fewer seats than they did in 2011. A number of high profile MPs failed to get re-elected. So what went wrong for the New Democrats and how does the party rebuild its support moving forward? Joining me now, BC NDP MP Nathan Cullen, who was re-elected, so congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Let's start with your part of the country,
yes.
Where the party did well.
Yes.
You picked up, how many seats was it?
We picked up a couple seats.
Yeah.
We did very well, particularly in Vancouver Island and some parts of Vancouver and the interior. So we felt okay, but by the time the votes were coming in for us in BC, not only had results already been released, but we could see this loss of some incredible MPs across the country and that we weren't going to be forming government. So it was very much a mixed kind of evening for us, to say the least.
Why do you think your support in British Columbia held in spite of all that, in spite of the fact that BC could see the results coming in, voters
right.
could see, and in spite of the fact that that there was a Liberal majority government, there was obviously a move for change. Why
mm-hmm.
why did it stick in British Columbia?
Well, the mood for change was very, very strong in BC. I would argue as strong as anywhere in the country, just from the polling that we saw going in and for months and months, that Mr. Harper was very unpopular there. Some of the policies seem to have struck a chord stronger maybe in British Columbia. C-51 was very unpopular, as well as some of the pipeline politics that you know very well. Mm-hmm. And you can see that also in the voting patterns, that Vancouver Island, the coastal communities that are under threat of these oil pipelines very much supported us and saw us as the vehicle to stop Stephen Harper. I think part of it was based maybe on our work, because we had done a lot of work on C-51, mm-hmm. Randall Garrison. We'd done a lot of work on pipelines, myself and Finn Donnelly. And so there was a natural dialogue that way. In other parts of the country, I suppose the dialogue looked different, but I can't speak to it, not having campaigned much there.
So what do you think happened then, overall, to the national campaign? Where do you think, is there a moment now that you can already say, that probably wasn't the right thing to do?
It felt really in the balance for me. You know, there was just these moments where it could have gone either way. What in particular? I don't know. I feel
for instance,
like
the balanced okay. budget promise. Was that
yeah.
ultimately something that was perhaps unneeded? Was it because it seemed like that then put the NDP in the same camp
sure.
as the Conservatives and the Liberals had this idea that could distinguish them? Was that something that damaged you guys?
Well, authorship is important. You know, if we had run the exact same spending plan as the Liberals had run, I don't think we would have had as many kudos, if I will, from some of the columnists and pundits. So I think our field on economics in particular as New Democrats is restricted. Even though borrowing from our past, the balanced budget approach is very much who we are genetically.
Mm-hmm.
We very much a pay-as-you-go kind of people, prairie populism, Tommy Douglas and all the rest. That isn't just a passing moment for New Democrats. That's actually, with a couple of exceptions to that rule, that is how we are. So it fit our genetic political makeup. A lot of politics is trying to skate to where the puck is going to be. And sometimes you get that right and sometimes you don't. We executed a plan that had started probably two and a half years ago. And a lot of it worked. A lot of it was doing very well up until that tipping point moment. And I think once that crossed, I think polls seem to have played maybe a larger role than I've seen in past campaigns, just the frequency of polling and it being a change election. As soon as pundits were able to push the narrative that we weren't going to be that alternative to Stephen Harper, or we didn't have the momentum, the big M, then it starts to become a self-supporting kind of dialogue, right? Oh, the one team's up by two, maybe they're up by four, and then it became what it became.
But, I mean, you've been in politics long enough to know it's not just polls.
It's not just what the
media narrative is.
Sure.
Was there a point where you thought, and I have heard this from other people in your party, that maybe the progressive message wasn't being pushed enough, whether it be on things like C-51,
right.
whether it be on some of the progressive policies that you had to offer, that maybe it wasn't being sold or explained to Canadians enough?
Maybe, but I suppose what I take from this is that this is a progressive country and voters voted for a progressive platform, which is what the Liberals offered. Now, part of the job going forward is to not have a repeat of previous Liberal governments where they run campaigns to the left but then govern from the right and forget a lot of those red book type of things. We don't need red book 2. We don't need a whole bunch of years in which people are disappointed. Because that's been part of that party's past. Now they are promising a different future, and that's going to be our job to hold them to account on changing C-51 dramatically, on proportional representation, changing the way that we vote in this country so that it's more fair, on dealing with climate change, not just aspirational targets, but real targets. Those are some of the things that we have. So your question was, did we promote ourselves as progressive? I don't know. I mean, we are a progressive party in our DNA. What we do and the policies we promote, from women's issues to the environment to the economics, is progressive. Maybe we took some of it for granted, but it's hard for me to say at this point. I think Tom did incredibly well. I think he was consistent. I think our position on the niqab was incredibly important for us as a progressive
movement.
But
damaging, you would agree.
Maybe, but I mean,
in Quebec, certainly it must have been damaging.
Well, we were dealing with Stephen Harper, who was in desperation mode and was I think, drowning and became very desperate. As damaging as it was to us, though, Rosemary, my greater concern is what it is for Muslim Canadians and to the fabric of this country, which is a multiculturally based one, that one group, for cheap political reasons, was pointed out by one party, by the Conservatives in this case, just to try to cling to power no matter what the cost. There is a cost that was paid, not by the Conservatives alone or us, but more importantly by Muslim Canadians, Muslim women. That concerns me. And there's going to be some repair that's going to be needed to be done in this country so that people do feel included and welcome and all of those other things.
So what does the party do now? I mean, you've got Tom Mulcair.
Yes.
Does he stick around?
Yes.
Until the next election, into the next election?
Yes. I mean, again, I go back to how Tom did during this campaign, which I thought was very well. Our rallies, I mean, again, I was more focused on BC, but I got reports from the rest of the country where they're just having huge turnouts and really strong feeling and positive. And 4 weeks before the campaign was over, we were feeling as good as we ever have. It's a new reality for the NDP because we come in having had a tough loss with 44 seats. Mm-hmm. Which, when I got here 10 years, 11 years ago, 19 seats was where we were at.
Yeah, I mean, that's a one-way spin. It. Yeah, sure.
Oh, it's not about spin.
You were the front runner for much of the campaign and then lost.
Yeah,
and
well,
now in third spot,
learning how to campaign as the front runner is also something new to us.
Yeah. That,
if you ask about what was challenging for us during the campaign, how to run with the lead is not something over the many decades of time the NDP has existed. We've had a lot of practice at. Mm-hmm. So we made some mistakes. Now we learned how to run as underdogs and how to run as the front runners. Both of those things you have to be able to do. I don't present this as spin. 44 MPs is a good start for rebuilding.
Sure.
We have some incredible people returning. We have some incredible new people coming. That's good for us. So as devastating as this is, and I lament the loss of voices like Megan Leslie and Paul Dewar and folks that I want in this conversation. I also know that my duty as a member of parliament, certainly to my riding, is to represent the northwest of British Columbia. And to this party, as we bring these new folks in, is to begin the rebuilding process. And we need to look back, and Paul Dewar and others are going to do that for us, and I think that's important. But the charge for us, for Tom, is looking forward, holding this government to account, and doing our job, because that's what Canadians expect. They voted for a series of progressive ideas that were in the Liberal platform. They want those things done. It wasn't simply about getting rid of Stephen Harper. That was a large part. And I do wake up this morning somewhat content with the idea that Stephen Harper isn't the Prime Minister, and that on a lot of his things that he held up as his strengths, accountability, the economy, we did a lot of the heavy lifting in terms of bringing that to a reality check and having Canadians realize, wow, the Conservatives weren't what they promised. It didn't work out the way we wanted, but for a lot of Canadians, they wanted to see the end of this kind of politics. And not take that for what it is, not just the end of Stephen Harper's prime minister, but the end of this kind of politic. And I think that's very important to make sure that that's the next step that we take together.
I'll leave it on this one. You've been open in the past to working with the Liberals. Mm-hmm. It was something that you ran on when you ran
that's
to
right.
be leader. Is the fruit of this election not proof that maybe that there is some opportunity for that? If the country is progressive,
right.
Where does the NDP position itself then?
Well, as the traditional and progressive stanchion in this country, so when we talk about things like affordability for consumers, we talk about things like climate change, we talk about things like changing the voting system, people know it's not just opportunism for us. It's not just something that polled well that week. Mm. It's something that we deeply, deeply believe in and want to see done. So holding these guys to account, I mean, we always say that as opposition. In this, we know those policies that Mr. Trudeau ran on. We were the authors of some of them, many of them, in fact. Being able to hold them properly to account will be not only natural for us, but incumbent upon who we are and the 3.5 million Canadians that voted for us.
Thanks, Nathan Cullen. Appreciate you coming in.
Thank you, Rosie.